What's up? I was hurrying. Where did he go?
Earnestly I seek you, oh my soul. I thirst for you, my body aches in a dry and weary land. I've seen you in your sanctuary. I beheld your power and shouted glory. My soul is full, my lips will sing your praise.
Glory of his name.
Good morning and welcome to worship. My name is Andres Flores and we have some announcements to share with you today that will enhance your connection to our church's mission and ministry together. First up, our annual Shoes for Orphan Souls collection will be happening throughout the month of August. We invite you to bring new shoes and socks for children and teens of all ages to the atrium. Your donations make a significant difference in the lives of many children and teens in need. Let's come together and support this wonderful cause. Next up, on August 21st and September 10th, we will host a meet and greet for our new minister with youth and families, Lily Langdon. This will provide a wonderful opportunity to learn more about Lily's passion for youth ministry and continue to welcome her to Hixson UMC. The meet and greets will take place on the courtyard patio here at the church from 6:30 to 8 p.m. You can sign up to attend using the link on our website. Lastly, we are thrilled to announce a new women's Bible study starting this September that will run through May. This deep dive into the book of Revelation will be hosted through the Bible Study Fellowship Network. The study will take place at Hixson UMC on Tuesday mornings and is open for all to join. Be sure to sign up through our website to reserve your spot today. Don't miss out on this enriching and enlightening study. As always, thank you for being a vital part of our mission, vision, and goals here at Hixson United Methodist Church. Have a blessed week.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to the River Service here at Hixson United Methodist Church. I'm Steve Bowman. I'm one of the lay leaders here. And the first part of that video was AI Andres. And the real Andres was at the end, but just joking. But anyway, back there doing the robot, so I'm showing my age. Anyway, welcome to the River Service. We're especially welcoming the visitors that are here with us this morning. Thank you for being here with us. If you are a visitor, if you wouldn't mind, before you leave, back there in the back on some of the tables and some of the areas back there, we've got a little thing that looks like a bookmark that has a little bit of information if you could give us about yourself, and then we can get back in touch with you and let you know a little bit more about what's going on here in the life of Hixson United Methodist Church. But once again, thank you for being with us here this morning. We also welcome those folks that are watching us on the World Wide Web. We're blessed, as we say every week, to be able to provide that option for folks that either are out of town or sick and or aren't mobile enough to get here. We're blessed to be able to provide that. So thank you for tuning in and watching us. It's Communion Sunday. It's always a special time. So I'm always look forward to the first Sunday of the month. I know a lot of people, kind of dread communion, but I think if you really think about it, and I think Matt's message today may speak to that a little bit, it's really a wonderful time. When we get to serve and share communion with one another. Most of you are familiar with our prayer station over here. Before the service, or of course while the band's playing, if you've got a prayer request or praise, or just want to spend a moment in meditation about whatever it is, please feel free to come over here and light a candle and do that. And since we've got a lot to do, I'll just turn it over to Pastor Matt.
Thanks, Steve, and also thanks, Stop Motion Andres. That was impressive. I want to see him do that in live time, not just on a recording. That'd be cool. Maybe next time he's on stage. But as always, welcome. I'm so glad to spend this time with you in worship. As always, we will begin our time of worship together with our call to worship from today's psalm, a selection from Psalm 51, parts on screen for one and for all. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity. Oh, we're off there. That's the second verse. There we go. No.
Mercy on me.
Let's just go with that one.
Stop motion on the stressing.
Call and response. You desire truth in the inward being, therefore teach me wisdom in my secret heart. Purge me with your medicine, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. If you could all stand, let us join our hearts and our voices as we worship together this morning.
Before the lion and the lamb, though every knee will bow.
Thank you, worship team, for leading us this day. You all may be seated. And thank you all for participating in worship. It is something that is the work and the task and the obligation and also the opportunity of the entire people of God to worship. So it is a joy to worship with you all this morning. Will you join with me in a word of prayer? Lord, in your sight, we are given our existence. Address us as your people, and we are enabled to hear. Enlighten our hearts and our minds and our eyes, and we may see. Remind us this day and all days that our existence, our salvation in and through this community of the faithful are entirely works of your grace. We may only claim faith because you have granted us faith. There is nothing natural or normal or expected which occurs where grace reigns. Offer us this day your radical, surprising, shocking grace which pulls up a seat at the table for all of us, which welcomes us home when we've squandered your blessings and journeyed into our various far countries, which clothes us for the wedding feast to which we've been invited, which finds us out when we are in the pit, into which we've been thrown by jealous siblings, which feeds multitudes from scarce provisions. Only by your grace and not by our own skills, talents, capacities, or capabilities may we know you and may we together be saved. We believe, Lord. Help our unbelief. Redeem us from the powers which we seek to serve in order to give our lives a meaning that you do not have for us. Reduce sin and death to the rubble from which they've come. Free us from the law and our constant desire to re-enlist in a common sense, rigid, black and white fundamentalism that trusts in our own abilities rather than in your grace. Free us for joyful obedience to the dynamic, lively spirit which draws us into the most unlikely and surprising situations and relationships and empowers us as your body to improvise accordingly. May we never forget that you are free and that we may only become free by offering ourselves up, emptying ourselves for others as you have emptied yourself for our sake and for the sake of the world. Forgive us our sins. Forgive us our rejection of your hard-won reconciliation effected and made real on the cross. If we need to be blinded to the workings of the world so as not to substantiate the world's suspicion that nothing different really happens here than anywhere else, then Lord, blind us. If we need to be silent so as to not bear false witness to your grace and goodness, shut our mouths. Form us, mold us, make us by your Spirit and grace your disciples and witnesses to all of creation, who like you would rather give up our very lives than to strike back in fear. Almighty God, all honor and glory is yours, now and forever. Amen. It's a joy of mine with a sunburnt neck and a cramping hand and a few blisters and splinters and the like to draw your attention to our ministry celebration this morning, our offering moment. It is the Sunday school class, the young family class. The slide says something a little different. Those are two different classes. It's easily confused. The young family class. And we lift up the young family class as a viable and vital ministry in and of themselves because it's just so concurrent and so just right there in hindsight and in foresight because they're actively at work in the ongoing provision for a member of their class. So back Memorial Day weekend, some of our folks here at HUMC and members of the young family Sunday school class had a little bit of a scare when Will Reed, helping someone move, Will took a fall out of a truck bed and damaged his spinal cord. So through the last several months, he spent time at hospitals here in Chattanooga. He spent time at the Shepherd Center in Atlanta. He spent time doing rehab, physical rehab at the VA hospital in Augusta, Georgia. It's been a long process. And as a part of this long recovery process, Will and Katie's home needed to be made more accessible for him so that when he got home, he would be able to, you know, return to work and be able to get in and out of the house. And so we have been working. I've had the joy, and Mallory, we had the joy of joining members of that Sunday school class along with other members of other classes here at HUMC and some other people besides. And not only the ramp was funded largely by Sunday school classes here, so that's something to celebrate because you know lumber's not cheap, but also have, you know, pitched in with tools and hands and backs and necks and everything needed to build a ramp and have been in the process this weekend of constructing this ramp. We're almost done. We do have work that's still to be done today, roughly from 1 to roughly 5. If you would like to join us, you are welcome. Holler at me. I will get you the address, and we will welcome your handiwork. But it is something that is worth celebrating. It's almost done. It's sturdy. I was walking out on what we've done, and I couldn't get it to shake, so that's a good sign. It goes as far as it's tall, inch to foot. You know, that's code and all. So it's a joy to be with our folks in mission, in ministry in this way, but it's a joy for me to see, because that is such a wonderful, powerful, poignant image in micro of what the church is meant to be as a whole. Pitching in when others have need, helping any and every way we can, going above and beyond for the sake of those who have met, encountered a certain need. And so I've seen that happen. That is ongoing. That happens here at Hixson United Methodist Church, oftentimes behind the scenes and by people who don't really want the spotlight, but it is worth celebrating nonetheless. So I lift that up as a celebration of all God is doing, as also a request for continued prayer for the Reeds, as Will continues to recover. As always, you may support the ongoing work of ministry and mission as we partner with God at work in ministry and mission to all the world by giving one of three usual ways: in service with tithing envelopes and the brown offering boxes on your way out of the worship space this morning, online on the website hixsonumc.org/give, or by text, knowing that that which we offer up, return to God from our blessings, God will use abundantly in the upbuilding and the construction of His kingdom. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for using us as instruments in the building up of your kingdom. Your Spirit has built this body, your church, for the sake of partnering with you in ministry to all the world. In moments of crisis and despair, we are called to join you in offering help, hope, and healing to each and every one we encounter. Just this weekend, Lord, you have called servants to participate in that mission and in that building. We give you thanks for the commitment of these volunteers and for your grace which enabled them to respond to your call. May the work accomplished this weekend be blessed and a blessing. May our witness always be that of sacrificial offering. And may you be glorified in our giving of our prayers, presents, gifts, service, and witness. Amen.
Please stand for today's scripture reading. And today's reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 6, verses 22 through 35. The next day, the crowd that had stayed on the opposite shore of the lake realized that only one boat had been there, and that Jesus had not entered it with his disciples, but that they had gone away alone. Then some boats from Tiberias landed near the place where the people had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. Once the crowd realized that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went to Capernaum in search of Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him God the Father has placed his seal of approval." Then they asked him, "What must we do to do the works that God requires?" Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." So they asked him, "What sign then will you give that we may see it and believe you? What will you do? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." "Sir," they said, "always give us this bread." Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." This is God's word for his people. Thanks be to God.
Seated, let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I'm sure that you have all come here this morning wondering just how we're going to deal with the most pressing public health threat that we face in these times. What is it about grandmothers? Really, what are we going to do with them? I don't know if this is your experience, but my grandmother just has no sense of portion or measurement of food. Go home for a birthday party, ask for a small slice of cake, and get a whole quarter of the sheet. Tell her you're not that hungry, but you're trying to be nice, so you'll eat a quick bite, and you receive a gallon container full of enough food to feed a small army. There's just something about them, love most likely, that causes them to demand that you have eaten your fill, and then some more, and then still given more to take home to eat later. It's almost like they want us all to gain weight. The fitness industry's biggest enemy, grandmothers. But there's just something about a grandmother's dogged persistence to provide for us that which we need and perhaps may show us something about the character of God. Now, when I say that God is a lot like a grandmother, don't hear that as me claiming God is elderly or infirm. After all, who would talk about their grandmothers that way? Instead, hear in that comparison me claiming that just as our grandmothers are so determined to keep us nourished and full, we're growing children after all. God is equally determined to keep us nourished and full. We're growing people after all. Jesus is on the move. Keep your eyes open. Pay attention. Don't get lax. You just might miss him. John 6 has been a whirlwind of divine activity in and through Jesus. Miracles have been performed that have whetted the crowd's appetite for more. What's he gonna do next? In fact, read a little bit back, a little bit before our reading began today, and you'll find that after the feeding of the 5,000, the people desire to elect Jesus president. And Jesus quotes William Tecumseh Sherman, "If nominated, I will not run. If elected, I will not serve." I bet you thought that was Lyndon Johnson. Nevertheless, Jesus refused the invitation to the national convention and gets the heck out of Dodge. People are missing the point. The crowds don't get it. John's gospel is astounding to me in this regard, and I've always found it a bit funny. Time and time again in John's gospel, when the crowd gets a bit too large, gets a bit too pressing, a bit too demanding, Jesus makes some obscene statement that they're destined to misunderstand and misinterpret. "Very truly, I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day." Eat flesh, drink blood? No thanks, Jesus, I'm a vegetarian. It seems Jesus would rather have a small group of followers who understand him than a large group who are bound to lean upon their own understanding and miss the point entirely. Therefore, it is John's gospel that warns us, do not hire Jesus as your social media manager. He will not do well. But those crowds are pesky, aren't they? When they realize that the boat which brought Jesus and his disciples to them is no longer there, and that only the disciples have set out to leave, they go on their own quest. Where's Jesus? We've got to find him. He wasn't in the boat that brought him here. And they take their own boats across the sea. Here the reader knows what the actors in the story do not. Namely, Jesus did not cross the sea in the boat with the disciples, he crossed by other means, namely a brisk evening maritime jog. When the crowd finds Jesus on the other side of the lake, however, they ask, Rabbi, when did you come here? How did you get here? Just what is the deal, man? They've traveled far. The food he provided for them in the feeding of the 5,000 has worn off, and their stomachs are beginning to rumble. Maybe he'll do it again. Ask him for more food. Say, we're really getting a little bit peckish, Jesus. You got any more of that bread and fish? And Jesus knows this. Jesus knows this is the reason they're seeking him out. After all, they've just got done trying to make him king. They know they like what he's got, in a sense. You were looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves, he tells them. They've missed the forest for the trees. They've stopped short of that to which Jesus' signs and miracles are meant to point them. They haven't gone quite far enough, far as they've gone. They focused upon his miracles. Jesus is now functionally a magician. We're waiting to see what his next trick is. He's a musician urged to play only the hits. And if you've heard any of my sermons over the last 13 months that I've been here, you know that it's generally not a good idea to try to take Jesus into our own hands and make of him what we wish. And so Jesus calls the crowds to not miss out on the significance of the signs. Don't stop short. It's a word the church overhears, but also needs to remember. He's talking to the crowds, but the disciples are a part of that crowd. The church, represented by the disciples, overhears this, even if they're not directly addressed, but they need to overhear it. We need to overhear it. After all, the disciples just a while ago were unaware how Jesus would provide for so many people with such little food. Seems like the church from day one has always been trying to tell Jesus what he can and cannot do. Don't focus on the food, Jesus tells the crowd. Focus on what the provision of the food represents. Look at the significance of the sign. Seek the food that does not perish but endures for eternal life. Well, that sounds pretty good. How do we get that food? What must we do to perform the works of God? Earn that food. Be paid with that eternal nourishment. Pretty good question. But the answer is not perhaps what we may want to hear if we ask it. This is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent. There's nothing to do. No work for which to conjure up the strength and determination. It is a work of God. God graces humanity with the ability to believe. Faith is not a work of humanity that we conjure up, or that we run the right equation or the numbers and aha, there's the solution. It's called faith. That's not what faith is. It's not a work of humanity, but a gift of God. And this is sustained by the food that Jesus provides that nourishes us into eternity. But first, okay, Jesus, but what? How are you going to substantiate this? What sign are you going to give us so that we may see it and believe you? Never mind the others. We need another one. I'm still hungry, you know. Prove it, Jesus. Moses gave our ancestors food in the wilderness, after all. What are you going to do? Back up your claim. Cite your sources. Isn't it fun to be interrogated by those who have less training than you? You're still missing my point, Jesus responds. Besides, don't talk Moses to me. You're reading that text all wrong anyways. Texts, after all, have no inherent or obvious meaning of themselves. You put a book in front of you and ask it to say something, you're going to be waiting a while. Texts have to be interpreted, discussed, handled by a community which has been formed to handle such a text, and which forms people capable of reading such a text. Moses didn't give your ancestors food, Jesus says. God did. What's more, God is still in the process of giving people food, abundant food, food which will not spoil with the passage of time, bread which gives life to the world. Okay, I think I'm tracking with you, Jesus. I think I'm with you. Give us this special eternal bread. Awfully hungry. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. The bread which Jesus provides is bread, but it is something else as well. It is the means by which God nourishes his growing people, his growing and going people, and prepares them for the journey through the wilderness that they must take. God offers his people nothing less than the entirety of himself, utterly emptied of all but love, that all may be filled. That's the gospel. Preacher and theologian and scriptural interpreter Eugene Peterson once remarked that we preachers typically preach one sermon our entire careers, just again and again, using different words, images, stories, texts, but for the most part, we're just saying the same thing again and again and again. I don't know if that's a compliment or not, and I don't know if I'm guilty of that or not, but I also don't know if that remark is untrue, Jesus included. Jesus is most engaged, oft quoted sermon begins in the most shocking, unnerving way possible. Blessed are the poor. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. And so on and so forth. Luke reports the sermon a bit differently, but frankly, Communion Sunday, we don't have time to delve into the synoptic problem and the numerous differences between the various witnesses in the witness that is Holy Scripture and why those differences really shouldn't bother us that much. We don't have time for that. Luke's reportage of the sermon occurs on a level place. It's not the Sermon on the Mount, it's the Sermon on the Plain. Blessed are you who are poor, Luke's Jesus says. Blessed are you who are hungry now. Blessed are you who weep now. Hear the difference? Regardless, whether we regard Matthew's or Luke's account historically accurate or devise some clever way of synthesis that the text itself never attempts, it's quite an introduction to a sermon. It's quite a weird way to start. Almost as strange a choice as calling grandmothers a threat to public health. But bear with Jesus and me just a little longer. What makes this sermonic starting point so disconcerting, so troubling, so attention-arresting is that it just seems patently false. The world certainly does not believe or behave as if the poor, the hungry, the meek, the mourners, and those prickly people that we call peacemakers are blessed. Usually those types of people are in the way. They must be dispatched, pushed off to the side so that the machine can roll on undisturbed and uninterrupted. But the Sermon on the Mount, or the Plain, is not Jesus asking us or telling us to do or be anything. Jesus isn't saying, be a little more poor, be a little hungry, be a little meek. Jesus is describing the world as God sees it and as God will have it. This is descriptive, not prescriptive language. In God's world, where it all looks so topsy-turvy and upside down, it is indeed the hungry who are blessed. The full cannot receive anymore. After all, we're pretty full, to the consternation of our grandmothers. In this, the hungry are blessed. because they are free to be filled. They are open to receive that which God grants. Jesus feeds his people. Jesus reminds us that it is ultimately about more than physical bread, but it is never less than physical bread. God always has been and always will be a God of provision, of offering, of giving. And as we, unnatural as it is, are engrafted into this holy community of priestly believers that we call church, we are given bread for the journey. Because Jesus is on the move, so we must be on the move as well. If we wish to receive the bread which will satisfy our hungry souls for all of eternity. Today, here, now, at this table, we are given the chance, the opportunity to receive just such remarkable provision from our remarkably providing God. Here we may see the body broken and the blood poured out, God emptied of all but love for your sake and for mine, that we may be broken and poured out, emptied, so to leave this place filled. And to be God's people sent into the world to fill all that is empty with the grace and love which will satisfy every longing and redeem every aspect of God's good creation. So, as your grandmother or your God might say, you look a little bit hungry. Besides, you've got a big day ahead of you. Here's some food. Are you sure you can't come and eat just a little bit more? Amen. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners, and that proves God's love toward us. So friends, family, in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ,
we are forgiven. Glory to God forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, who with your word and Holy Spirit created all things and called them good. In Jesus Christ, your word became flesh and dwelt among us. Through Jesus' suffering and death, you took upon yourself our sin and death and destroyed their power forever. You raised from the dead this same Jesus who now reigns with you in glory and poured upon us your Holy Spirit, making us the people of your new covenant. On the night before meeting with death, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine, that in the breaking of this bread and the drinking of this wine, we may know the presence of the living Christ, be renewed as the body of Christ for the world, redeemed by Christ's blood, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, in God's holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And as God's reconciled people, let us join our voices together in praying as our Lord taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. If my servers and the worship team can come forward at this time, and then we will invite the rest of y'all up. Each station has gluten-free elements. If you need that, be sure to ask your server. But otherwise, as the people God has invited to his feast and made ready to receive, come, feast.
Be still, there is a healer. His love is deeper than the sea. His mercy is unfailing. His arms a fortress for the weak. Let faith arise. Let faith arise. worship you for Abel. Be still, there is a river that flows from Calvary's tree, a fountain for the thirsty. Your grace that washes over me.
Really good timing. We didn't plan that. Friends, it is a joy to get a small taste, to recognize a sign and the significance of that sign, to receive from God's bountiful goodness a bit of bread, a little bit of juice, but so much more, to receive just a taste of the fullness that is Jesus Christ himself, the Lord, the love, the life of God. So friends, as God's hungry people, stay hungry. Keep ready to receive more and more as God offers you more and more of his grace, of his goodness, of his love. And together, as God's hungry people, by God's grace, we may be filled, and so may be the whole world. Go in peace.
Let us go forth and make disciples of all nations. Show them the love that God has bestowed on us. And as we send forth, let's show peace to others, the same peace that we have shared in this past hour here. Bestowed on us, and as we send forth, let's show peace to others, the same peace that we have shared.
Back in the day.